Good morning. Welcome to our Sunday worship service. I'm very glad that you are joining us this morning to worship the Lord together. If this is your ever first time watching our video today, please feel free to contact us and connect with us as you send us a message via YouTube or visit us on Facebook, our Facebook page that is on facebook.com/saltandlightem. And so please visit us, give us a message, stay connected with us, and we'd love to get in touch with you. A few announcements that I have for you this morning. Please listen carefully because they're going to be very, very important. First of all, we have our youth group. For our youth group, there will be continuously Wednesday discipleship from 8 to 9 p.m. via Zoom and Saturday Ignite going through the book of Judges at 4 to 5 p.m. via Zoom as well. For junior high, if you are in junior high, please remember you'll be in the Zoom fellowship as well at 2 p.m. And the information, you can find it in the YouTube description. For our Salt and Light members, we also have our Sunday fellowship at 12 p.m. via Zoom. Our daily devotional and prayer has been finished. And so thank you for joining me early in the morning or whenever you were available to watch the video together and do your devotional with me. Another one is that we have now something new called the House Church. We're transitioning from a small group to a house church. Now, I want to briefly explain to you what a house church is compared to a small church. While all the core remains the same, which is we still seek to connect with one another, to care for one another, and find community through the house church, we are meeting during the week rather than Sundays. And so right now, on May 8th, which is this coming Friday, we're going to have our ever first house church via Zoom together. And more information will be found on our Facebook page. Also, your small group leaders will let you know about more information as well. The house church has a structure and is also very missional oriented. And so we're seeking to be more having an evangelistic idea through a house church model. So please get ready for that, be excited, and join us via Zoom on Friday, May 8th at 7:30 p.m. Another announcement is that today and next week, we want to do a special offering for those financially affected because of COVID-19. And so if you have a generous heart, if you have a heart to help, if you would love to help, especially our church members who are struggling these days, please give an offering today and next week with a memo that says EM COVID-19. You have to write down the memo, EM COVID-19, so that fund particularly will be used to help those in need during this COVID-19 time. So make sure that you are putting down EM COVID-19 under the memo, and more explanation will be also said during the offering time. At this point, we want to read Psalm 67 together and meditate on it. Psalm 67. May God be gracious to us and bless us and make his face to shine upon us, Selah, that your way may be known on earth, your saving power among all nations. Let the people praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you. Let the nations be glad and sing for joy. For you judge the peoples with equity and guide the nations upon earth. Selah. Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you. The earth has yielded its increase. God, our God, shall bless us. God shall bless us. Let all the ends of the earth fear him. Let us pray together. Gracious God, we thank you for this morning, and we thank you that we can come together still in a virtual way to worship your name. I pray, God, that our hearts will be ready to worship you. May you continue to work in our hearts so that we may not be distracted by anything as we lift up your name and as we sing words of praise to you. So, Father, may the Holy Spirit guide this time. May he be filled within us. And I pray, Lord, that this moment right now will be one filled with joy and filled with comfort, encouragement from you, and also one where we can continuously be challenged in our hearts to live according to your ways. So, Father, may this worship be all about you, and we pray this all together in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
my soul now to stand. And you stood before my failure and carried the cross for my shame. My sin weighed upon your shoulders, my soul now to stand. counting your status as nothing. The King of all kings came to serve, washing my feet, covering me with your love. If more of you means less, take everything. Yes, all of you is all I need. Take everything. My life and my treasure, the one that I can't live without. And here at your feet, my desires and dreams I lay down. And here at your feet, my desires and dreams I lay down.
As you give our offering as an act of worship, there are three ways how you can give today. One is by PayPal, and the other is by Zelle, and another way is to send checks to our church. You can see it on the screen and the instructions on how you can do so. Also, if you would like to give your offering as a donation for COVID-19, please make sure that you are adding the memo or the note that it's going to be EM COVID-19. Make sure that's going to be added on there. Let us take a moment to do our offering today.
I know I But because of grace, because of your mercy, I stand here unashamed.
Let us pray together. Heavenly Father, we are thankful to you that you have given us life, a new life, through your Son, Jesus Christ. And Father, today we have given our offering to you as a sign of thanksgiving, but also following, obeying your commandments that you have given to us. So God, I pray, may you bless the offering that we have given to you. I pray, God, for those who are struggling these days and still have given to you with faith, may you bless them. And may all of our offerings, Lord, be pleasing to your sight. Father, I also pray, some of us have given to help those in need because of COVID-19. As you remember in the book of Hebrews, in chapter 13, verse 16, it reads, "Do not neglect to do good and to share what you have, for such sacrifices are pleasing to God." I pray, Lord, that our acts of offering to help those in need may be one that is pleasing to your sight. And even though it may not be much, may you use it to comfort those in need. May you use it to help them, Father, and continue to remind them that there is a community who cares for them and that ultimately you, God, love them more than anyone else. And so, Lord, I pray, may it be glorifying to you as we have given our offering to you. Also, at this time, as Pastor DC preaches and speaks to us through your word, I pray that you will open up his heart and his lips that is guided by the Holy Spirit. May he speak with authority, with power, and truthfulness, Lord, that all of the words that he speaks out may be one of conviction, may be one of clarity, and also one that is truly glorifying to your sight. We thank you, Lord, and now speak to us, Father, through your servant, Pastor DC. We praise all together in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning, and thank you for being here with us. As a young kid, one of my most earnest prayers was, "God, please, please, whatever you do, God, I'll do anything else. Please don't call me to be a pastor." The irony, right? The reason why that was my prayer growing up was because I grew up being the son of a pastor and having seen my parents go through so much hurt, pain, betrayal. There was something inside me, there was a lot of anger. And I said, "God, there's just no way that I can forgive people who hurt my family members. If you hurt me, that's one thing. But you hurt my dad, you hurt my mom, you hurt my brother, and you mess with me. And I'm going to take my blue belt degree in Taekwondo and send you to outer space." That's how I felt growing up. So the very sinners who had hurt my parents and my brother and myself, our family, were the very reasons I told God I never want to preach to or be asked to love sinners. God, there's just no way I can do that. And I began thinking as I grew up, Lord, that pain carried on with me. And what really hurt was thinking, God, my future wife, my future children, I don't want them to experience what I had to experience growing up. I don't want them to feel that pain that I had to feel. Trying to love and serve the very people that end up turning their back on you, turning smack about you behind your back, gossiping about you. When you try to do good for them, they do bad to you. And that really hurt me. But as I continue to grow in my faith, as I continue to understand the depth, the width, and the height of God's grace, his love, and his mercy, God began to do a surgery in my heart. And what began as an absolute focus on sinners who had hurt me started shifting my perspective into loving sinners because God first loved a sinner like myself. And so to talk more about this Savior who is worthy to follow, to talk more about this Savior who is able to transform and forgive us and to change us from sinners into saints, from enemies of God to friends of God, please turn with me to Luke chapter 5. Luke chapter 5, it is the third gospel account in the New Testament. Luke chapter 5. I'm going to be bouncing around here and there, but the two main passages that we're going to focus on in Luke chapter 5 are the calling of the disciples. When Jesus calls Peter, James, and John, and then later calls Levi. And so as we read this passage, I pray that we'll get to see who the disciples were when Jesus first called them. And then afterwards, we'll get to see who Jesus is, the one who is worthy to be followed. So first, let's talk about the disciples, because when the disciples are mentioned in Luke chapter 5, they were the ones who were unworthy to be a follower. The disciples were unworthy to be a follower. Start with me in Luke chapter 5, verse 8. But when Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, "Depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord." For he and all who were with him were astonished at the catch of fish that they had taken. And so were James and John, sons of Zebedee, who were partners with Simon. And Jesus said to Simon, "Do not be afraid. From now on, you will be catching men." And when they had brought their boats to land, they left everything and followed him. Peter's calling was to become a follower of Jesus Christ and to leave his life as a fisherman. So if you can imagine the daily grind of going fishing, this is something that we do now, modern day time, more as a hobby, something that we do on a family vacation, something that we do just to get away from the busyness of our work and our lives in the city, to go out into nature, to enjoy catching fish, maybe to make sashimi or sushi out of it. But for Simon, it was a daily job, something that he had to work really hard at, spend nights up casting nets, cleaning nets, catching fish, cleaning fish. And if you don't know anything about being in the sea or the fish, it's not the nicest smelling thing. So that's what they were constantly around. And I imagine Simon Peter maybe at times feeling the daily grind, just dragging his net. First step, second step. How much longer do I have to do this? Am I going to be catching fish for the rest of my life? Is this all there is to my life? And while we may not be dragging nets, I believe that we can relate because we too drag our feet. There are times where we get so used to the daily grind of things, so used to doing stuff. I know right now in the COVID-19 shelter at home, especially for a lot of students, a lot of people working from home and doing online schooling, maybe you've gotten too used to the new norm now. Maybe you've gotten used to what we call the Zoom attire, where you look good on the top and you're in your pajamas on the bottom. Maybe that's the new norm that you've gotten used to. But now you're starting to feel like, oh, when is this going to be over? When can I go hang out with my friends? When can we actually have fellowship? When can we come back to church? And so as we drag our feet, maybe we're finding ourselves once again without purpose, waking up to an alarm, dreading another day of life, going to sleep, worrying, what are we going to do for breakfast? What are we going to do for lunch? And then what are we going to do for dinner? COVID-19 has been a wake-up call. It's been a wake-up call because it has disrupted our daily schedule. It has disrupted our daily living and the freedom that we took for granted. And as I've been thinking about this, I feel like it's really exposed how complacent and how content we've become. For those of you who are tuning in right now, and if this is the first time you've ever heard the story of Jesus calling the disciples, or if this is your first time ever hearing about this man named Jesus Christ, I pray that as we continue through this message, there will be a feeling and a burning in your heart that you cannot ignore. And I pray that if you are already a disciple, if you will consider yourself a Christian, if you will consider yourself a member belonging to the body of Christ, I pray that this will challenge you. Because when Jesus first called Peter, he left everything that he had just to follow Jesus. So can you imagine, finally, I found purpose in my life. Finally, I no longer have to catch fish, but I can be a fisher of men because that is the authority that Christ has given me, and that is the person whom I follow. So next, we're going to go to Levi and his calling in verse 27 of Luke chapter 5. It reads, after this, he went out and saw a tax collector named Levi sitting at the tax booth, and he said to him, follow me. And leaving everything, he rose and followed him. A little bit of background about tax collectors back in these days. There were not people that other people liked. Tax collectors, a lot of them were corrupt. They would charge taxes or collect taxes, but they would actually increase the true tax amount to pocket their own, to make their own profit by cheating people out of money. They were also taxing Jews heavily as a representative of the unpopular Roman government. And so tax collectors, I would imagine, would not be the first person you would think God would call to be a follower. And yet that's exactly what Jesus did. He called Levi, a tax collector, and simply said, follow me. The one line, the parallel verse that keeps these two accounts, the calling of Peter, the calling of James and John, and the calling of Levi connected, is exactly what they did. If you look at verse 11 and verse 28, we see the same thing. They left everything to follow Jesus. Disciples are ones who are unworthy to be a follower. And yet when Jesus calls us to be a disciple, we leave everything because he becomes our everything. And I want to ask you, disciples right now, Christians, church members who have been attending our church, who have been attending our services, do you still feel that way? Because I feel like that's another thing that this COVID-19 pandemic and crisis has exposed in our hearts, our own idolatries. Are we willing to give up what we have right now to continue to be a follower of Christ? Or has something, somewhere along the way in our journey with Jesus, have we settled for just simply good enough? Have we settled of being a complacent follower? As long as I just go to church on Sundays, I'm okay. As long as I just join for monthly prayer meetings, that's okay. As long as I participate in small group and what's coming up in the EMS house churches, that's okay. Is that all there is to a relationship? Imagine getting married. Imagine getting married to the woman or to the man of your dreams, and God blesses your union and your marriage, and you come together. And then a month into the marriage, let's say, for example, the husband just, you know what, honey, I love you, but I just hate doing the dishes. So for the rest of our marriage, I'm not going to do the dishes anymore. And that's how they commit to the marriage. How would you feel? What kind of relationship is that? But I feel like that's exactly what we've done with Jesus. At first, we're like, Jesus, we're going to do everything for you. I'm going to follow you. I'm going to give up everything. I'm going to donate money. I'm going to give offerings. I'm going to help the poor, the homeless. I have all these passions. I have all these desires. But somewhere along the way, we fell out of love. Have we become like that indifferent spouse or the indifferent friend? Have we become indifferent as a disciple of Christ? If so, I pray that there will be a sharp turnaround and a sharp poking at your heart where God will rekindle and reignite that fire in you to follow Jesus, to proclaim him as your everything, to want to pursue him passionately, and to proclaim him to everybody else. Why? This leads us to our second point. Jesus is the one who is worthy to be followed. Jesus is the one who is worthy to be followed. I'm kind of going backwards here. I first talked about the call of the disciples, but there's context behind that. If you go back to Luke chapter 5, verse 1 with me, it reads, on one occasion, while the crowd was pressing in on him to hear the word of God, he was standing by the lake of Gennesaret, and he saw two boats by the lake, but the fishermen had gone out of them and were washing their nets. Getting into one of the boats, which was Simon's, he asked him to put out a little from the land. And he sat down and taught the people from the boat. And when he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, put out into the deep and let down your nets for a catch. And Simon answered, Master, we toiled all night and took nothing, but at your word, I will let down the nets. And when they had done this, they enclosed a large number of fish, and their nets were breaking. They signaled to their partners and to the other boat to come and help them. And they came and filled both the boats so that they began to sink. I read this, and the first question that comes to mind is, who is this man? Who is this Jesus to wield such authority? Who is this Jesus to have so much power that as simply at his command, the professional fisherman would allow him to use his boat, would row him out, and the professional fisherman would actually take advice from a non-professional that's not even in the same profession? And yet something was so authoritative about Jesus. Something just demanded and commanded his attention and his obedience. Now, what did Peter say? He said, "Master," once again in verse 5, "we toiled all night and took nothing, but at your word, I will let down the nets." So he's like, "Jesus, we tried. Trust me. I do this for a living. I know where the fish are. I know how to catch fish, but we didn't catch anything. And now you're telling us to do that same thing again when there is nothing to be caught?" And yet something was different about Jesus. So he obeyed, he followed. The professional fisherman listened and followed the profound fisher of men. That is how Peter came to understand the greatness in whose presence he was fishing under. It is so powerful. So his first response is, "Depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord." He understood his fallen estate. As we come face to face with our worthy Savior, we have to come to terms and grips with our unworthy self. That humility a disciple should never lose. Because this is what I see in the church. This is the tragedy of the church right now. We become saved, we become Christians, and somewhere along the way, we shun those who are unworthy in our eyes to hear the gospel. If they don't fit into our category of what a churchgoer should look like, we push them out. Or if there's a church member acting up and doing sinful things, we start judging them. And we say, "How can this person call themselves a leader? How can this person be a teacher? How can?" And we start judging people and we lose sight that we too are unworthy sinners. I pray that God will remind you and give you the same heart as he did Peter when he first said, "Depart from me, for I'm a sinful man, O Lord." That confession should come forth from our lips every single day. God, we are so unworthy. We are so sinful. But you are a worthy Savior who redeems us and saves us. And if we go into the Levi's account, it shows us why Jesus is the one who is worthy to be followed. He's worthy to be followed because he is the great physician. Watch this. Verse 29, "And Levi made him a great feast in his house, and there was a large company of tax collectors and others reclining at table with them. And the Pharisees and their scribes grumbled at his disciples, saying, 'Why do you eat and drink with tax collectors and sinners?'" Right? The irony is here is that they're not seeing themselves as sinners, but the righteous, holy people. "And Jesus answered them, 'Those who are well have no need of a physician, but those who are sick. I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance.'" Highlight that, because that is the beautiful truth and the mission of Jesus when he was on this earth. He came not to call the righteous, because no, not one of us are righteous. All of us are fallen. All of us are depraved. All of us are sinners. And so when we hear the news, this is the good news, that Jesus didn't come to call the righteous. He came to call sinners to repentance. That means every one of us who are unworthy, he came to call to repentance and to save. He is the great physician of souls. After I accepted Christ into my life, he began a lot of healing in me. But one of the things that took a long time was forgiving those who hurt my family, forgiving those who betrayed my parents' trust and left our church while trying to tear it apart from the inside out. And so when I got into college and I felt this tiny little splinter in my heart, I said, "No, God, please don't. There's no way. There's no way." But that splinter began to grow deeper and deeper, and it became something that I couldn't ignore. And then finally I called my mom and I said, "Mom, I think, how would you feel? How do you feel if God called me to be a pastor?" And while my mom, yes, she is married to a pastor, she's also my Korean mom. I don't know of any Korean parents that would celebrate, because I was on the track to go pre-med try to go into the medical field to be a doctor, I don't know any Korean parent that would be happy when their child says, I'm going to give up my pursuit of a medical career and become a pastor. So with a little bit of fear and trembling in my voice, I asked her, and she said, DC, when you were in my womb, I prayed that God would use you as a healer. And when you said you wanted to pursue the medical profession, I praised God because you would be a physician of the body, that you would hear people physically. And yet, now, if God does call you to be a pastor, he has still answered my prayers because I believe he's calling you to be a physician of the soul. And that sank in so deeply with me because God was first and foremost my physician. He was the one restoring me, healing me, challenging me, allowing me to become more like him as a forgiven sinner, giving me a bigger heart to forgive others. And as this happened, the desire to follow Christ, to tell others follow him and preach his word began to grow. And that's what I would call a spiritual splinter. So as we conclude, my fellow brothers and sisters, is there a spiritual splinter in your heart? Is there something that you just cannot ignore, a burden, a tension, an itch that you just cannot scratch or satisfy? Because I believe that is the Holy Spirit who has splintered you, so you cannot ignore his call in your life. Will you choose to follow Christ as your Lord and Savior? This calling is simple. Jesus simply says, follow me. Have you made that decision? If you haven't, please get in touch with us somehow. Please leave us a message. Please contact us through our website or Facebook. Let us know how we can journey with you right now. Even if we have to, our first meeting is online, I would love, we the pastors and the staff would love to introduce our Savior to you. And for the rest of you, for my brothers and sisters in Christ, I have a challenge for you. As disciples, when the Lord allows us to come back to church, when God is going to allow us to recongregate here at church in person, I don't want to go back to what church used to be. And I say that with the utmost love, but also I want to say it in a gentle, rebuking way. Because the way we used to worship, when we would come on a Sunday morning, we would drag our feet out of bed. We would drag our feet into Sunday service. And as we would praise God, it was as if Jesus was still in the tomb. Where is the resurrection? If that's the kind of worship that we're going to come back to, I don't want any of that. I want to be dedicated, passionate, fiery disciples of Christ. When we come back to church and we see other disciples, to explode in worship. None of that weak sauce stuff. None of that watered down stuff. Where is the fire in our souls, Christians? That should be the fire burning inside of us right now. And if we have gone down that slope of being a judgmental disciple, if we have judged others, this person is too unworthy, this person is too gossiping, this person is too whatever, whatever this, whatever that, I don't like this person. And if we have made church simply about our comfort zone and the people that we like, it's time for a serious heart check. Because Jesus even called tax collectors. Jesus calls unworthy sinners to repentance. And if I can echo the words of Paul, I believe this is the heart that we all should have. Jesus calls sinners to repentance, of which we are the foremost. We are the greatest sinners. And once we can come to terms with that, we'll finally understand if Jesus can forgive an unforgivable sinner like me, who are we to withhold the beauty of the gospel from others around us? Disciples are called to make more disciples. The fishermen were called to be fishers of men. I pray that that fire will burn in us so that even right now, even within our communities and our neighborhoods, even at work, even online, we would passionately proclaim Jesus Christ, Lord and Savior, who is worthy to be followed. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you would call sinners like us, that you would give us the gift of repentance, that you would help us to realize the true tragedy of how wicked and sinful and fallen we really are. That's the bad news. And as we come to terms with the bad news, I thank you so much that the beautiful good news is there to redeem us, that the beautiful good news is there to save us. For the good news shows us and tells us and reveals to us that the perfect Savior died for imperfect sinners. So God, if there's anybody tuning in right now and they have yet to proclaim you as Lord and Savior, Holy Spirit, may you do a work in their hearts where they will proclaim you right now to be their Jesus. And I pray for my fellow brothers and sisters in Christ that this will be a wake-up call for us to mobilize and to reignite that flame and that passion and really evaluate our hearts. Have we been a faithful disciple or have we been complacent and content? God, I pray that we will stop hitting that snooze button, that we will stop spiritually hibernating. But as you give us that spiritual splinter, help us to not ignore it any longer. But may we rise up, may we wake up, and may we go out into this world to call others to follow the one who's worthy. It is in Jesus' holy and precious name we pray. Amen.
Before we go into a response song to the message that we just heard, can we transition first into a time of prayer? And as we do, I ask that you would continue to worship together with us. First, the first prayer topic that I have is I would like for us to pray for continued safety as well as even greater vigilance as a lot of or some of the restrictions for COVID-19 is being slowly lifted. This happened on Friday, and I'm not sure what will result of this, how it'll change things. But nonetheless, I know that there are a lot of us, a lot of people out there who are just itching to get out of the house, itching to get back together, to start gathering again. And I hope that that doesn't lead to a lot of unsafe gatherings, a lot of unsafe things happening, where after this many weeks of being in shelter at home, working hard through that time, where we just blow it all on just this little itch that we have to gather, right? Let's continue to persevere in this. Let's continue to practice safety so that we can ultimately see the day where we can freely gather together once again. And so I'd like for us to pray for that safety. I'd like for us to pray for all of the leadership, people in leadership positions who are having to make these kinds of difficult decisions because they don't really have that many things to go off of. They're making very difficult calls, very difficult decisions for the safety of many. And so let's pray for wisdom to come upon them and for us as citizens to respectfully follow. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, I thank you so much for just these several weeks that you have continued to protect us and helped us through this time. As we continue to practice safety, as we continue to practice vigilance in trying to keep safe, keep protected from ourselves. That we would continue on, Lord, that our anxiety wouldn't lead us to make rash decisions, but that we would continue to not looking for the short-term temporary things, but looking for the long-term things, Lord, so that we can ultimately gather back into your house to be able to work without restriction, without any hindrances. Lord, I pray for those in leadership positions who have to make these decisions so that to I'd like to read to you from Acts chapter 2. I'm reading from verse 42. It says, "And they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers. And awe came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were being done through the apostles. And all who believed were together and had all things in common. And they were selling their possessions and belongings and distributing the proceeds to all as any had need. And day by day, attending the temple together and breaking bread in their homes, they received their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to their number day by day those who were being saved." Amen. This time, I'd like for us to pray for our church. Why I read this passage for this topic is I would like for our church, just as Pastor DC preached, for us to come back different, to return to our church building and to gather physically different from when we left it. The church that we see beginning in Acts 2 is a tremendous example of what a church should be like. Especially during a time like this when there are so many that are struggling, some that are struggling behind the scenes where we don't even know. I wonder, how many of us are praying for them? Right? Even without knowledge, how many of you are praying for just church members saying, "Lord, if there are any in need, I really hope that they are being cared for. Or would you help for those people to come to my knowledge so that I may help?" How many of you, knowing that there are those who are struggling in your church family, are actually going out of your way to be like an Acts 2 church member, selling your possessions, figurative or literally, to provide for those who are in need? This church began because there was an outpouring of the Holy Spirit. They were filled with the Holy Spirit, and that transformed them. And I believe that we too, the church today, we are filled with the Holy Spirit. And so what stops us from being like this church? And so right now, I would like for us to pray for our church so that we would be constantly thinking of one another, even though we are distant, right? Even though we are in our own homes, that we are, during this time, worshiping together loudly. That this worship that we are giving to the Lord is just a foreshadowing of what is to come when we return to our church building. That when we finally are able to set foot into our church once again, that there would be a joyous noise, that there would be a celebration, not because we're finally able to get out of our homes, finally able to just come to church and just see friends that we haven't seen for a long time, but because we're able to worship together again. And so I would like for us to pray for our church, all of our church members, that we would have this heart either to be reignited in us or to continue to stir in us, that the Lord would stir this all up in us. And so that we would not be waiting to get out of the house, but that we would be daily wanting to just worship again and again. And as our view is set on heaven, that we would be wanting to step into the church so that we can experience a little bit of that as we worship together physically again. And so as we continue, as we pray for our church, also please remember all of our elders, our pastors, especially our senior pastor, as those leaders have to make decisions for our church, that God's wisdom would continue to pour into them. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, I want to pray for our church. I want to lift up to you our church. We're so thankful for all of the people who are constantly working hard so that online worship is possible. But Lord, we're so anxious to just get back into the church. To close, please pray with me the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we have also forgiven our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
I've been through, use it for dreams that are yet to come true. All of my hopes, all of my plans, my heart and my hand are lifted to you. Lord, I offer my life to you, everything I've been through. Use it for your glory.
Let us confess our statement of faith together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From there, he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Universal Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Now may the amazing grace of our worthy Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and the limitless, unfailing love of the Father God Almighty, and the comfort in the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, remind us daily to live out our lives as disciples of the worthy Savior, now and forevermore. Amen.
If more of you means less of me, take everything. Yes, all of you. Yes, all of you.